In this lecture, we are discussing the conquest of India from Britishers' side, how they conquered entire India step by step. So that is also with respect to Governor Generals. So this aspect is vast aspect. From Indian side, we can say the rulers of India and how they were dealing out with each other, etc. But here I am discussing from the Governor General and Viceroy. From that point of view, the conquest of India and what remedies they used, or whatever the modifications they performed during that, or whatever their rule was there. So it is not necessary that every Governor General or Viceroy should carry out some reform everywhere. For example, let me clarify again, I am using two words, either Governor, Governor General or Viceroy. The difference is that in earlier days means when company was established in India, after that they set out their factories all over India. So various places, say for example, one factory was set out at Surat, another factory was set out at Madras. In those days it was called as Madras, now it is called as Chennai. Then at Kolkata, it was called as Calcutta at that time. So like that, they set out their factories. Now, the factory was having chief, that is called as governor. So, for example, Bombay Presidency, the chief of Bombay Presidency, that is Mumbai now, at that time it was Bombay. So, Bombay Presidency, then that was called as Bombay Provincy, then that was called as Governor of Bombay, Governor of Madras, Governor of Calcutta or Bengal, like that post were there. But in latter phase, they were having problem of communication, because England to India, that no direct communication was established yet, and for that purpose they were in requirement that local authorities should be there, and like that they annexed out Bengal as a first province in India. Keep in mind, earlier days they were having Mumbai, that Bombay Islands, in their hand. They were having their factory at Surat, but here they got entire province, that Bengal province was there. And then when they controlled that Bengal province, they got particularly first land in India to administer. So the difference is that Bombay Presidency a small part, or say Surat only factory and surrounding area, but here straightway they got entire province by defeating out the first Sirajuddaula, that is in Battle of Plassey, and then onwards they were able to control the vast territory. And so Governor of Bengal, or that is called as Governor of Calcutta, that was called as Governor of Governor General of that India. So initially it was not as Governor General, he was Governor, but now they termed him as Governor General. So if at all in local problems are there, then that local problems will be solved by Governor General, that means Governor of Bengal. And in latter phase, that Governor of Bengal was termed as Governor of India, that is Governor General of India. Now see, particularly this era, say for example, we are talking about first Governor General here, that is of Robert Clive, of Bengal, that is Robert Clive. He was there from 1757 to 1760, and again from 1765 to 1767. Now, he was called as Governor of Bengal because Robert Clive was initially a clerk in East India Company, but because of his efforts, he was able to conquer the war with Sirajuddaula, Nawab of Bengal. He was defeated and later on executed by Robert Clive. Now, Robert Clive was considered as founder of British Empire in India. If you are talking about Robert Clive, then he is called as equivalent to the king, that is Prussia. Prussia is actually part of Germany now. So Prussian Emperor named as Frederick the Great. So Robert Clive was compared with them, particularly Lord Chartmell. He said that yes, Robert Clive is equivalent, his work is equivalent to Frederick the Great of Prussia. If you check out on map, the vast territory was under control. Say for India, Bengal is only one province. It can be there in corner, eastern corner of India. But for Britishers, if you check out map of Britain, then for them, the Bengal province was so vast that even more than area of England was under control of them at that time by defeating out Siraj ud-Daulah. Very unfortunate to say, we were not aware about what we have. Bengal province was really rich province. Industries were there. Lot of agricultural activities were there in Bengal. And what is the most important thing, that in East India means eastern part of India, because Britishers called it in entire today's India as East India. So in those days, in eastern part of India, Bengal was important trade center, particularly Dhaka was important trade center over there. And then they got control. So Robert Clive onwards, we are talking about governors of Bengal. Now see, 1757 to 1760 and 1765 to 1767. During this period, Maratha rule was dominant in India. Maratha suffered a terrible defeat, as it is given in history, from Ahmad Shah Abdali, that is Emperor of Afghanistan and rebellant Emperor of Persian Empire. He betrayed Nadir Shah's descendants and carved out his own empire in Afghanistan because he was disciple of Nadir Shah. Ahmad Shah invaded India as his Nadir Shah invaded, and then he dealt with Maratha army. There was a series of battles. Out of that, the last battle, what we are saying, that is Battle of Panipat, that was lost by Maratha army. But it is said that all war is series of battles. It is said that Maratha army were they were able to conquer, regain, they were able to regain their own territories again. And so we were not defeated in that battle, sorry, that war. What we were defeated in the battle. So whatever the opinion, they are different. But here we are going to say that, okay, after that terrible loss in the Battle of Panipat, Maratha army lost over control over northern part of India. For Britishers, Maratha army was really a challenging one, because they tried to make certain attempts to crush down Maratha power when it was in beginning only. But later on they realized that they were not able to crush Maratha power immediately. Instead of that, Maratha power was growing. And then this battle with Ahmad Shah Abdali proved Britishers a lot of positive thing in order to expand their empire. Particularly because they were opportunistic, and then they spread out their empire during this absence of Maratha power in North India. For example, Mughal Emperor was under now control of British power, particularly company government. Now, Robert Clive ultimately ruled over Bengal. He used various techniques. So for example, the important technique I must tell, this is something, dual government in Bengal. That means revenue was collected by company, whereas administrating work was given in hands of local people. See, how they have sacked out India at that time, that only income we are going to take, administer, you have to administer yourself. Like that things they carried out in Bengal. Again, keep in mind, Bengal was very, very rich province at that time because of various industries were there in Bengal. Agriculture in Bengal was advanced, and the most important thing, trade center. Now here, Robert Clive got this power, but he is termed as a corrupt person, not from Indian side, from England also. When he returned back to England, Parliament of England only started blaming them, and therefore Robert Clive was having problem. He started under influence of liquor. It is said that he committed suicide. We don't know exactly what happened. But the thing is that a lot of corruption was there during Robert Clive's work. Then next viceroy that was ruling over Bengal, his name is Wellrust, So his name is Wellrust. He ruled for only 2 years, that is from 1767 to 1769. But during his rule, nothing much more is achievable. Only thing is that corruption and anarchy situation was there during his rule. Next, Cartier. He ruled for nearly 3 years, that is from 1769 to 1772. But his rule was also having same thing, that lot of corruption and lot of problems were there in his rule. And now, the next ruler or next governor was there, that is 1772 to 1773. Initially for this 1 year only, his name is Warren Hastings. Then onwards, he continued till 1785. Why Warren Hastings is important over here? The first thing, he started newspaper during his rule. Then he encouraged imperialism of the company. Then he decided, and obviously because his empire was there, he decided various policies that will make stronghold of British Empire in India. He established Supreme Court at Calcutta at that time. At district level also, he established various courts, whereas he transferred treasury from Murshidabad to Kolkata or Calcutta at that time. Now, he abolished the thing, that is dual governance, because it was creating lots of problem. He abolished that. He was appointed as first Governor General of India. Particularly, this thing happened at 1773 and he ruled till 1785. Now, he established collectors for each and every district. He established Royal Asiatic Society, then judiciary system and revenue collection, both were taken in British hand. Whereas during his rule only, he faced first Anglo-Maratha War. So actually, it is not first Anglo-Maratha War, but in modern period, particularly after they established their power in Bengal, it is said that first Anglo-Maratha War from that point only. So from 1778 to 1782, that first Anglo-Maratha War was there. Ultimately, they committed a treaty that is called as Treaty of Salbai. Now, during his rule, he observed two important things, that is Regulating Act and Pitt's India Act. So these are achievement of Warren Hastings. He was ruling till 1785. We are discussing these all about Governor Generals of Bengal, obviously. So as we discuss about Warren Hastings, then we are discussing about Sir John Macfarlane. I'm revising. Sir John Macfarlane hardly ruled for 1 year, that is 1785 to 86. He was just for temporary basis only, comparatively a weaker leader, and not much of the achievements are there during his rule. Next viceroy, next Governor General of Bengal, his name is Lord Cornwallis. Now keep in mind why I am again and again saying that Governor General of Bengal, because say Lord Cornwallis was ruling from 1786 to 1793. That was his phase. So during his rule, that 1786, Maratha Empire was again achieved its zenith. Mughal Empire was under control of Maratha Empire now. And then, except Bengal and fewer provinces, fewer small territories, entire India was not under control of Britishers. And therefore, his rule was there, but his rule was there in Bengal only. No doubt, they were claiming that, yes, governor is considered as Governor General, but his rule was practically enforced over Bengal territory only. Now, Lord Cornwallis, he is again really important person in development of India. First, he developed judiciary system. That means whatever the system was given earlier by Warren Hastings, that was also not perfect one. So there was change, it was improved. Then, during his rule, he established a new code that is called as Cornwallis Code. He started out a revenue system that is called as permanent settlement. This is really worst thing. I am not able to call it bad. Like that system was there from Indian side. But for British side, this system was a really good system. I am talking about Lord Cornwallis, who started out this system, that is permanent settlement system. Now, he also started Indian Civil Services. So, his that important thing that he started out this Indian Civil Services. Now, he started out Penal Code. And then, judiciary system was established. He established police stations, then British Civil Services in India. Then, he determined the revenue rate also. The maximum revenue can be collected from land, he decided that is 89% nearly. It is said that 10 by 11. That means suppose farmer is giving 11 part, total is produced, then maximum we can take 10 part from that. So nearly 89% that number is there. Now I am talking about this permanent settlement system. And you will realize why we call it as worst. Clause number one. Earlier rulers, though they were Hindu ruler, Muslim ruler, whatever that, they were collecting out taxes. For example, during Alauddin Khilji's rule, for Hindus, nearly 71% taxes were charged. But that is off the crop. Whatever you are generating out crop, out of that we have to get that taxes. Some modifications in system were there, for example, Kankut system. In that system, they started estimating out. So prior to harvesting, they were started estimating out the approximate yield and then they defined tax. But again, keep in mind, whatever tax was there, that was only on what you earn. Okay. Now here, in this part, what they decided that let us take an average. For example, previous 10 years. So take that average, that whatever your yield was there. And out of that, we have to consider that yield as fixed yield. And out of that tax was collected. Again, tax was collected not in terms of grains, but in terms of cash. This is hardship for Indians, because at that time barter system was prominent, whereas this collection of cash was really difficult. Say for example, you are today also aware, for example, now I am recording this lecture in 2019, at some incident when crop is there, for example onion, let us take example of onion. At some instant, the rate of onion is around 2 rupees per kg. I am talking about rate that was taken by farmer to the wholesale, that traders. So, farmers are hardly getting 2 rupees per kg. And sometime rate of onion is so high that even farmers can earn 20 rupees per kg. Farmers can earn. Traders, they are earning a lot. But farmers, they can earn around 20 rupees per kg if rate is high. But usually, farmer is not having capacity to store out the goods. So whatever material is produced, if he is able to store, then it's all right, because he will check out when that rates are high and he can able to sell. But Britishers were asking tax during those days, immediate payment, and then obviously they were not getting good rate for their material. But Britishers fixed out a tax that, okay, say for example, particular farmer is getting 100 for example 100 bags, or rather I should say 1000 kg. Out of that they fix out, okay, you have to pay suppose 700 kg. So don't pay 700 kg material. Suppose that rate of that crop is 1 rupee per kg. So pay 700 rupees. And that was really difficult for farmer. They establish a person that is called as landlord. In local language, we called it as zamindar. So that zamindar or landlord was appointed. Usually big farmer in village was considered as zamindar, and that person is responsible to collect out taxes. He is responsible to collect out revenue and pay it to government. So landlord become more loyal to government, and farmers, the small farmers, were getting exploited. Ultimately they mortgage out their land in hands of the zamindars, and they lost out in latter phase. They become landless peasant on their own land. That is the tragedy from Indian side of British rule, particularly over Bengal. This is the worst part that Lord Cornwallis achieved in order to benefit England. So this is a mere piece of exploitation of Indian. So whether we have to decide we were getting very good justice, we are having new administrative system, civil services, and for that we have to bless Cornwallis, or we have to blame Cornwallis, because he, on that account, he exploited India, or rather at that time part of India, to a very great extent. Anyway, he waged war. During his rule only there was war with Mysore. So Anglo-Mysore war was there during his rule, and that's why we are saying that Lord Cornwallis is really something like we are talking about friction in physics. We are calling that friction is necessary evil. We are calling necessary as well as evil. So this Lord Cornwallis is something like necessary evil here. In this lecture, we are discussing about how Britishers conquered India, part by part obviously, but with reference to governors, governor generals and viceroy of India. So this is second lecture for this. In first lecture, we discuss till Warren Hastings, that 1773 to 1785. Now we are discussing about next governor. Actually in that lecture we discuss about General McFarlane. He was just for temporary base 1785 to 1786. Now after that, the important person was there. His name was Lord Cornwallis. He started, as we discussed in earlier lecture, he started civil services in India. Then we are saying that he prepared law, that police stations were established, like that part we discuss. Then onwards, we discuss about Sir John Shore. He was ruling for 5 years, that is 1793 to 1798. But not much of the remarkable things happened during his rule. Now, next important governor general, his name is Lord Wellesley. He is the important person. So if you are saying the foundation, really foundation, actually say British power developed in India step by step, I can't say that only one person is remarkable. They were having policies and they were governing according to that policies. But in that policies also, the remarkable policies, we are saying about Robert Clive, because he laid down foundation of British Empire, as we say. But practically, various other people, they are also involved in that. But here, after Robert Clive, the Lord Wellesley is really important person who we can say that whatever the foundation was given by Robert Clive, that foundation was converted into almost entire skeleton of building that is carried out by Lord Wellesley. He was governor of Bengal. Now his first period of ruling, that was there from 1798 to 1805. You can check out again the remarkable thing that in 1803, Maratha power came to end. Not 100%, but we can say it was kept on ventilator like that. So that 1803 war, that is important. Totally, if you are saying about Lord Wellesley, then the remarkable achievement, the first achievement, he defeated Tipu Sultan and killed him. Now, the second Anglo-Maratha war, which was a really high-class piece of diplomacy by Britishers, that was played during Lord Wellesley's rule. Then, the thing is that he started out a policy. That policy we are going to emphasize little bit more here. That is called as subsidiary alliance scheme. I'm going to explain little bit about this subsidiary alliance scheme. If you trace out the root of this type of scheme, they are there in the some sort of insecure nature or insecurity feeling to Indian rulers. They were not having self-confidence and they were checked out continuously by some outsider forces initially. For example, the Turk invaders, later on Mughals and all that. And so kings were accepting some protection, usually from emperor. Now when Maratha rule developed, or it was in stage of developing, at that time important policy was laid down by Maratha chief, that is collection of Sar Deshmukhi, that is 1/10 of revenue from the rulers, those who are not part of their empire, outside part of their empire. In return of that, they were promised that we will not attack on your territories and we will not plunder your territories. Apart from that, if any third party is going to attack you, we will provide you protection. Okay, so this was somewhat basic part here. Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj started this type of policy to give this type of protection to nearby territories people. Then onwards, Peshwa emphasized this only and started getting lot of income from other territories. Even Maratha rose out like a superpower for a while. And at that time, even Mughal emperor started getting protection from Maratha power at that time. And that is the cause that Abdali versus Maratha war was there. We are saying this is Battle of Panipat. So all these things happened because of to establish supremacy. Now here, Britishers studied out this all and they made some sort of similar policy, but more fruitful policy. I'm going to explain that. That is called as subsidiary alliance plan. First thing, Britishers showed us their powerful nature, how their army is well trained. Actually, This is also not discovery from Britishers' side. French people first discovered this way, that Indian troops can be trained like European troops. And then we can use them as a powerful machinery in the war. Similar policy was established by Britishers now, and they started giving very good training to Indian soldiers. Obviously, soldiers, they were going to get very good performance, but the way they were teaching, that was not that good, as we believe. Anyway, but they were paying very high salary at that time. It was around 7 rupees per month for a soldier. So it is paid army. As we discuss about Alauddin Khilji, as we discuss about initial Maratha rule, Britishers also insisted paid army. That means, say, whether there is job or attack, we have to attack, we have to make war or not, you will get a fixed income. Now, in that paid army, they started giving training and all that. And the trained army was there to show the power here. Say, for example, Carnatic War. In Carnatic War, initially Britishers were defeated, but they were defeated against French. And in last war, they make success. French were defeated. So this is the establishment as British army is superior. Then at Battle of Plassey, Britishers got success. In spite they were having very, very less army, somewhere around 700 soldiers. Whereas Siraj ud-Daula was having more than 50,000 army. And then also Robert Clive played diplomatic war. And Siraj ud-Daula was betrayed by his own governor, own general. And therefore Siraj ud-Daula lost out the battle and then he was beheaded. This is the proof that Britishers are more superior in war technique than Indians. And then the Battle of Buxar, where three major power in North India, one was Mughal Emperor, second one was Nabab of Awadh, named as Shuja-ud-Dawla, and Mir Jafar, the Nabab of Bengal, ex-Nabab of Bengal. All of these were defeated at a time that is called as Battle of Buxar. And this way, Britishers advertised their army. And then they asked the weaker kings to accept this subsidiary alliance plan. This is particularly given by Lord Wellesley. What is the idea? Britishers will provide you army. So you will get complete protection from invaders. They will not sack out your territory anytime as they want. So you will get complete protection. That is the first important clause in case of this. The second, for that purpose, you have to pay us. But how you are going to pay us? So for that purpose, you have to give territory in hands of Britishers. Britishers will collect revenue from that territory. It is not that you have to pay in terms of cash. That responsibility you have to give in hands of Britishers. Britishers will collect revenue from a particular territory allotted to them, and then they will maintain army. That means the ruler was not supposed to pay directly, but pay in form of territory. That means his collection will decrease automatically this way. But that he will not able to keep an army then. Why? Because he is already, suppose he is earning X amount as a revenue. Out of that Y is taken by Britishers. So what income is there with that ruler? That is X minus Y. Only that much. And then how he can spend again some amount over army. So he was not capable of maintaining more army. So automatically he reduced his army. The soldiers, which were not on job now, they were given job by Britishers. And this way Britishers got army, which was loyal to Britishers, but paid by Indians. So this is the biggest achievement we can say, that Lord Wellesley's this plan, how intelligently this plan was there. Again, the clause was there that this army will be used for defense purpose only, not for attack. And what is the guarantee? that you are going to defend and not attack. For that purpose, our resident must be there in court. He will observe all status, whatever going on in court, that will be observed by him. And then he will give report. Then only we can say that yes, this is the way of attack. Somebody is attacking you and we are going to defend. And for that purpose, British resident will be there in court. Now this is something installing spyware in your mobile phone. That a resident will be there in your court. He will guide king. If disputable matter is there, then he will guide that king. And the most important thing, that whatever going on in your court, apart from war, then that is also everything noted by British resident. But Indian king started accepting his subsidiary alliance plan. And because of that, Britishers got territories in India to rule directly over them. They started collecting revenue from that. They started gathering army. So army was gathered in India at cost of India, but that army was loyal to Britishers. And the most important thing, Indian rulers getting weaker, and then they were controlled easily by Britishers, because one king accepted this, then neighbor automatically accepted this. And initially smaller kingdoms accepted this subsidiary alliance plan. But in latter phase, Nizam from Hyderabad, he was a big ruler. Actually, Nizam, we are saying Nizam, actually he is called as Nizam-ul-Mulk. If you are aware that Mughal Emperor was there, at that time, Mughal Emperor was appointing somebody as a governor of different areas. They were called as Subhedar. So Aurangzeb was appointed as Subhedar of Deccan by Shahjahan. Latter phase, Aurangzeb became emperor and he appointed somebody as Subhedar of Deccan. But in latter phase or latter life of Aurangzeb, especially for last 27 years of his life, he entered in Deccan. He stayed in Maharashtra and defeated Adil Shahi Kingdom as well as Kutub Shahi Kingdom. A new territory was conquered and he appointed officer named as Nizam-ul-Mulk. After Aurangzeb died out, Mughal Emperor appointed this person Nizam-ul-Mulk to control over the territory. But henceforth, after death of Aurangzeb, Mughal power or Mughal Emperor getting weaker and weaker. And therefore, Nizam-ul-Mulk, no doubt he was governor appointed by Mughal Emperor, was started behaving like independent king. Sometime he was obedient to Mughal Emperor, sometime no. And then he was controlled by Britishers and he accepted subsidiary alliance scheme in 1798. Then onwards, Mysore. Then Tanjavur. Tanjavur was ruled by Maratha at that time. So that was also accepted. Then Awadh, 1801. And then in 1803, there was war, that is Anglo-Maratha war. Actually, this war, we say that lost out by Maratha in 1803, but practically the Peshwa means Prime Minister, accepted this plan in 1802 by the Treaty of Basin. Actually, it is Vasai. British strongly called it as Basin. So the Treaty of Basin was there, and then Bajirao Peshwa II was installed by Britishers as a Peshwa of Maratha Empire, and he accepted subsidiary alliance plan. Followed by that, there was war at Nagpur, and Bhosle from Nagpur, they also accepted this subsidiary alliance plan. Then Shinde or Sindhia from Gwalior, they also accepted this plan, and this way Lord Wellesley was able to control vast Maratha Empire by subsidiary alliance plan. But in 1803, they were having control over Delhi as well as Agra, because Maratha power was not remain powerful now. They accepted all this subsidiary alliance plan. Peshwa was installed, and then Mughal Sultanate became just a dummy or like a puppet. And then Britishers conquered Delhi, Agra, these important cities. And that's why you will come to know that Delhi was not capital of India during British rule. They developed their capital city as Calcutta in initial stage. Today Kolkata, those days Calcutta. Now, after this is the all achievement we can say that is about Lord Wellesley's rule. So, remarkable viceroy, we can say Lord Wellesley. Again, keep in mind, I am discussing everything, how Britishers conquered India with respect to all these viceroys, our governors or governor general. So I am repeatedly speaking, but yet we are not talking about governor, we are not talking about viceroy yet. Now, next, Lord Cornwallis was again, but he died out in Ghaziabad immediately in 1805. Then George Barlow, he ruled for 2 years till 1807. Well, after him, Lord Minto. So we have this some repeated name. For example, in Indian National Freedom Struggle also one viceroy was there named as Lord Minto. So here this is also Lord Minto, so we are calling this Lord Minto as first, or he is also called as Sir Gilbert Elliot. So the Sir Gilbert Elliot, and he was also having title as Earl. Why? Because that Sir Gilbert Elliot defeated Napoleon Bonaparte in the France. Napoleon Bonaparte was important emperor, great emperor in Europe. So he was defeated. Now, no much of the remarkable things happened during 1807 to 1813, because Maratha Empire was now on degraded. We are saying it is actually on ventilator only, but still it was not end of Maratha Empire. Britishers were planning, cunningly they were planning out something, but it was not coming out as what we can show, but it was going on. And then the important person is there, his name is Marquess of Hastings, or he is also called as Earl of Moira. This person is important. He ruled from 1813 to 1823. Here the third Anglo-Maratha war was fought. They started dealing with Peshwa in such a manner that the picture will be created that Peshwa is against Britishers. Britishers are not against Peshwa. And ultimately, Peshwa was defeated in the war. Then, that war is taking place in 1818. Maratha Empire was badly plundered by Britishers at that time. Each and every fort, in Maharashtra there are many hill forts. More than 300 forts are there in small territory. Each and every fort was destroyed by Britishers at that time, inclusive the capital, first capital of Maratha Empire, where Shivaji Maharaj was coronated, that is Raigad, that was also badly destroyed by Britishers at that time. Almost each and every fort, with fewer exceptions, were conquered and destroyed by Britishers at that time. This person is Marquess of Hastings. On behalf of him, there was General Prothero. He ordered to destroy fort. Why? Because he studied out war between Aurangzeb and Maratha. Aurangzeb was going to conquer fort within 6 months or some period. Maratha army was going to reconquer it. Aurangzeb conquered almost each and every fort, but lost out again. To avoid that, they decided that how to conquer Maratha Empire. So first conquer their fort, destroy that. Not a single person should be able to stay on fort, make them like that, or even go on fort, because they are hill forts, so some roads are badly destroyed, so nobody will go on that fort, and therefore empire will not exist. So this way Maratha Empire was defeated. That happened during Marquess of Hastings. Now he established Bombay Presidency, that around 1818. Then he is dealt with some people, they are called as Pendhari, the plunderers simply. Then he decided to spend 1 lakh rupees for educational purpose. So this is something new strategy British has started, that make education in India. We are going to discuss that under next few lectures when policies are there, how to rule longer period over India for that purpose. Now, he established another system of revenue that is called as Mahalwari system, particularly Punjab and Agra, newly conquered territories, where he established this type, that Mahalwari system. Earlier days we discussed about the system that is called as permanent settlement, but here they use this type of system. The difference was that in case of permanent settlement system, if season is going well and more crop is generated, then Britishers were getting less revenue. To avoid that, they fixed out some revenue over territories. That territory is called as Mahal, and that territory they started demanding. So something like in metropolitan cities or various cities, already we have municipal corporations, but apart from that, we are staying in some cooperative housing societies, where to maintain that building, that cooperative housing society is working, and then municipal corporation is charging out taxes, for example, water tax. So if water tax is charged, they are saying that okay, X rupees you have to pay. How to divide in your houses, that is your responsibility. So something like that they carried out, that is Mahalwari system was established. Then in India there was system of Gram Panchayat, the village panchayat we can say, that was established. Then Indian newspapers were started during his rule. English Empire established in Malabar, Karwar, Coimbatore, Madurai, Dindigul. Now in this area they fused out another system, that is Rayatwari system and Mahalwari system, both were fused. In Rayatwari system, because Maharashtra was conquered in latter phase, so Rayatwari system, they say that we are claiming not revenue, we are not charging any tax on agricultural activity, we are just collecting out rent, because land belong to Britishers and Britishers are giving you that land for agricultural purpose. So whether crops are good or not, that is not our question. We want rent of that land. And like that, they started collecting out rent. And if farmer is not able to pay that rent, then Britishers were having option that we can auction out your land. So like that, systems were introduced here. Then a new judiciary system was started during this period only. So this is we are talking about Earl of Moira or Marquess of Hastings. Welcome. In this third lecture about Governor General of Bengal, India and Viceroy of India, I am revising again that we are discussing how Britishers conquered India and what reforms were there while conquering India. Very, very brief. With respect to these governors of Bengal, India and Viceroy. So like that we are discussing with reference to. Okay, so here I am not completing out entire history, otherwise you may think that okay, all history is completed. So in last lecture, that is in second part, we discuss, that is about Marquess of Hastings, or he is also called as Earl of Moira, who ruled till 1823. Now from 1823 to 1828, there was Lord Amherst, or he is called as John Adams. Now, he established Education Council, that is in 1823, whereas he is not there to achieve much of the thing during his rule, because already Maratha Empire was conquered in earlier days only, whereas vast empire was there and that was ruled effectively. Now they started out the concept of education here. So for that purpose, they established this public education council. He got Earl Amherst of Arakan medal. Why? That is because of Burma war, Burmese war. Myanmar was called as Burma at that time. So that is the award he got. But the next important Governor General of Bengal, I'm intentionally again saying Governor General of Bengal. So his name is Lord William Bentinck. He is the remarkable person here. Now first, there was a problem of sati in India. You are aware, it is according to our social reforms, this is the worst problem. Many problems were there, but out of that, this should be, we have to consider it as good as rank one problem for women in India. The real problem was that after death of husband, in many communities, women were forced to go as a sati. This is a literally murder of women. Whereas, at some incident, it was not mandatory, but with own wish also, women used to go to sati. But that wish is not with affection and love with husband always. Apart from that, after husband, who is going to ask her in the society? Like that, various problems were there in the society, and therefore some of women were preferring to go to sati. Obviously, some were having this love and affection, may be possible, but we are aware that is say for a while. It is not necessary that after death of husband, woman should go sati always. But in many communities in India, all over India, the many communities preferring out that the woman should go to sati. And then this really problematic thing was there in India. Lord Bentinck stopped this by making a law. This is Prohibition of Sati Act in 1829. Obviously, this act was carried out by himself, but under influence, we can say, or effective explanation by great reformer Raja Ram Mohan Roy. Now, Lord Bentinck carried out, this is very good thing for Indians. At that time, over 1,000 years this tradition was there, but according to Lord William Bentinck, he was able to stop this by law. Practically it was not enforced immediately, but no doubt he said that according to this law, that the person who encourages this all, sati, that will be considered as a criminal in murder case, and case will be filed according to that. So with help of this effectiveness, within very short period, the practice of sati was abolished in India, and therefore we must be thankful to Lord William Bentinck for this reason. I'm not saying totally thankful, but for this reason we must be thankful to Lord William Bentinck. And obviously the most important person behind this is obviously Raja Ram Mohan Roy. But with that all efforts of Raja Ram Mohan Roy, William Bentinck also agreed this, because politically this is really important thing, because Indians, we are aware that we were very rigid, and many of us are very rigid towards our religion, and therefore this may get adverse effect on British rule. By knowing that also, William Bentinck accepted to carry out this act. And that's why I say that we have to say thankful, most thankful to Lord William Bentinck for that. Then you are aware of certain ill-tempered people in the society. Generally, we call them as thug. And they were, to great extent, during enforcement of British rule. They started British rule. Prior to that, these thug were dominating out various parts of India at that time. Reason may be possible after Aurangzeb, no strong Mughal emperor was there on North India, and may be possible because of that these thug were become dominating. So Lord William Bentinck was able to control the thug effectively. Then he tried to stop the infant death or killing of infant particularly, whereas he was expansionist in nature. Now see the other side. For social society, he carried out lot of things, but he was expansionist in nature. Whereas he carried out another system, that is system of jury. That is in 1832, he started a system of jury. He established industrial institute. Then he was considered as a very good effective ruler. Then he also stopped the trade of women. Okay, trade by now, trade of women, he stopped. And then the civil services, at that time various services were held by Britishers only. So he said that we have to enroll Indians in this all services. So that is the important thing carried out by William Bentinck. And then the most important thing, that with his expansionist policy in 1831, he conquered Mysore, whereas in 1834 he conquered Coorg, that is in Karnataka. Now say, I am talking about William Bentinck once again, that he was a really great person for social reforms in India. Yes, whatever he was doing for betterment of British Empire. Keep in mind, he was not doing for betterment of Indian community, for betterment of Indian British Empire in India, and then onwards byproduct is development of Indian community. Now here a little bit change is there, that henceforth 1833 onwards you are aware that act is there, and accordingly Governor General of Bengal was started calling as Governor General of India. So that is major achievement. Say 1818, you are aware that in 1818 Maratha Empire collapsed out, and then Britishers conquered that empire, and then onwards initially it was under Bengal only, but now they decided, all right, now nearly 2/3 of additional India we have conquered, and so the Governor General of Bengal, this term is renewed as Governor General of India. Again, the first Governor General of India is Lord William Bentinck only. So this term is there from 1833 to 1835. Now in 1835 they established educational system according to Lord Macaulay. Now he offered higher post in British services, and he encouraged British education. I'm coming to this point just for few minutes. See, earlier way there were two views regarding education in India. You are aware that in India, North India particularly, Mughal court, they were having administrative language as Persian. After advance of Nadir Shah from Iran, then onwards Mughal court decided to keep Persian back, and then they adopted official language as Urdu language after many years. But still India was having influence of Persian language because of this Muslim rule all over India. Time to time they were present, so Persian was considered under official language. Education was there in Sanskrit, Persian, Urdu and various local languages. So what was the view that and the most important thing, when Britishers got empire, many evidences are there that they destroyed existing educational system first. and then onwards they decided to establish their education system. So here there was a change, that some view of Britishers, that was Indian should given their own education, Indian education only, and that is also in Indian languages. Whereas another view was there, that is to educate Britishers, to educate Indian in British time. We have to give them English education and modern education. You are aware of Aristotle, and he given the task to Alexander the Great that conquer world, and world is divided into two parts, Greeks and non-Greeks. We have to convert non-Greeks into Greeks. At that time also, when we are discussing these all concepts, we discussed that this philosophy, this ideology is inherited over the centuries, and now it is inherited by Britishers. Only the word Greek is replaced by English, and this way we got now English education according to Lord Macaulay's theory. Now here, surprisingly, Raja Ram Mohan Roy supported British and advanced education. His view was right according to him at that time. And therefore, according to this concept that Indians should be given as English education, and now Indians are asking for that. So like that, the matter was put forward, and then English education, the advanced education, was sanctioned for India. Now here, the concept was given by Lord Macaulay. According to him, we have to train Indians like British people. We have to train them to become an ideal clerk. And so, whatever things that is there in British Empire, Indians will start admiring it. And once this type of cultural supremacy is established, our empire will be stable in India for longer time. Nobody says that we will rule over India perpetually, but our empire in India will remain for longer time. And that was basic idea. And all these things were carried out by Lord Bentinck. And for that purpose, he started giving something like carrot, that okay, get English education. After getting English education, you are getting higher post in government. You will get government job and like that. After William Bentinck, another person established, ruled as governor, that was Charles Metcalf. He is responsible for newspapers in India. See, step by step, the first education, then followed by that newspapers. Newspapers will propagate certain views, and the educated people, or like that we are saying elite class people, will go through that, and they will propagate that view as their own view. Basic idea is something like that, and therefore they started giving freedom to newspapers. So Charles Metcalf was able to abolish these regulations over newspapers. Certain laws were made lenient one, and then he made the Press Act, that is of 1835. Now Lord Auckland, he ruled from 1836 to 42. Now he started encouraging Indian languages, education in Indian languages also. Then he established medical college at Mumbai, at that time Bombay, and Madras at that time, today Chennai. Now during his part of Governor Generalship, there was first Anglo-Afghan War. Obviously, whatever the war with Afghanistan, Britishers not able to crush down Afghanistan as Britishers were able to crush down Myanmar or Maratha Empire. But Afghanistan lost out various territories in hands of Britishers after a series of war. And now whatever remaining is a small piece of Afghanistan that is remaining as Afghanistan. Otherwise, major part of Afghanistan is now, at that time it was part of British Empire, but now it is part of Pakistan. especially northwest frontier region of Pakistan, then Baluchistan province, like that territories were originally territories of Afghanistan. Britishers got these territories from Afghanistan, and that's why the Baluchistan is not called as Baluchistan during British rule. It was called as British Baluchistan because part of Baluchistan is there in Iran. At that time, Persian Empire. So like that, whatever territories acquired from Afghanistan, they were now part of Pakistan. At that time, they were part of British Empire. So northwest frontier region in Pakistan is not actually part of India. It is part of Afghanistan at that time. But you are aware that according to our ancient tradition, entire Afghanistan was part of India only. Particularly that part, today Pakistan hold, that is northwest frontier region part, and towards eastern side of Afghanistan, whatever today's Afghanistan, that is eastern side, that togetherly was called as Gandhar province. As you are aware, during that Mahajanapada etc., we discussed this part. So the war occurred during Lord Auckland's governorship, that is first war. Then he abolished the practice of firing during religious movement. They were having idea that they were using fire in air, so they stopped that practice. And the most important thing he achieved, that he abolished pilgrimage taxes. So that is the important thing. Now Lord Ellenborough, his next Viceroy, Governor General Lord Ellenborough, during his rule, he was arrogant, but he lost out war at Afghanistan, whereas he was able to gain control over Sindh. Initially, the Sindh were accepted subsidiary alliance plan during 1839, but during his rule, they planned to conquer Sindh, and Sindh was under now direct British rule. Now, Lord Harding, next Viceroy, ruling from 1844 to 1848. Now, Prohibition of Sati Act was there, but it was under British rule, not under princely states direct rule. You are aware that princely states were under Britishers, but they were having a sort of thing, we are calling it as dominion status. So laws etc. were made according to their own choices. Only fewer things were dominated by Britishers at that time. Now they dominate this way, that okay, you have to also carry out this same act, that is Prohibition of Sati Act. And then another thing he achieved, Lord Harding first, okay, what is that? That government jobs will be given to those who are able to read, write, or the one who is having knowledge of English. So this way, first policy was made by Lord Macaulay. And from Macaulay onwards, the policies were, practically speaking, we can say enforced by various ideas that, okay, take British education, you will get government job. Okay. From that period, these policies were penetrated. The fruit is today in front of you. Let us go further. That, he established canals, he established very good irrigation system at Haridwar. They digged out canal for irrigation purpose. Then first time the railway should be there in India, this concept was developed. And the most important thing, I must admire Lord Harding for the thing that he started out Sunday as a holiday in India. So this is the importance of Sunday, was carried out by Lord Harding. Then he also spent good amount of money for repairing or reconstruction of various prayer houses. So this is also important thing. He comparatively lessened out taxes over salt, whereas British versus Sikh, that is Punjab, war was there, and they signed out treaty at Lahore during his rule only. The another thing he carried out, that there is some tribes in Orissa. At that time, Orissa, today Odisha. So that tribe, that is called as Khod, where the human sacrifice was common for them. So he abolished that practice of human sacrifice also. Now, this is all things carried out by Lord Harding first. Whereas, now we are going to discuss about Lord Dalhousie, the prominent viceroy, prominent Governor General in India. Lord Dalhousie sometime compared something like a problem for India. Why? Because first he started a concept with lapse. We are calling this as doctrine of lapse. Doctrine of lapse means we have to simply dissolve princely state into Indian Empire. Whatever reason, initially they started saying that we don't recognize the adopted son as legal heir of your empire. Now you are aware, in last lecture only, we discussed about his subsidiary alliance plan. With subsidiary alliance plan, already a resident was there in court of king. Whereas, army, British army was kept in his empire. Whereas, for that, a land giving some revenue that was given to Britishers. As a result, king was not able to sustain his own army with him. And so, king minimized his army, because now we can't expend twice that my army and British army for my protection. And so they vacated out, or they reduce, minimize their own army. And now the thing is that this is the most dreadful act were carried out by these people, because now British army was dominating. Simple, whatever the person is having power, they will emphasize their power. And like that, British started emphasizing their power over princely state. The first victim here, that is Satara. You are aware that this is capital of Maratha Empire. Whereas, prominent capital was at Satara. Acting capital was something like Pune. So, in 1848, Satara was dissolved. Against this injustice, the representative of King of Satara, the name of King of Satara was Raja Pratap Singh, whereas his representative was Rango Bapuji Gupte. He fought with Britishers, first with company, then he went to England. He filed cases in England also, but after nearly 8 years of consecutive work in England, he realized that there is no meaning of this fight. What is justice and injustice? The thing is that simple, those who are having power in hands, they are really powerful. We can't fight. And therefore, he returned back. His memoir is there in Satara. Today also, if you are going there, there is a place called as Charbinti. This Charbinti place is a memoir of this Rango Bapuji Gupte. Followed by that, Jaipur and Sambhalpur in 1849, they were small piece, small princely state. Then Baghet, 1850, Udaipur from Rana Pratap's father. That state was continued, but that was dissolved in 1852. Then onwards, Jhashi. You are aware of that famous queen of Jhashi, Rani Lakshmibai. So, she was also from Satara. But then onwards, she married with that king at Jhashi. Now, Jhashi was dissolved in 1853. Then onwards, Nagpur. You are aware, Nagpur was controlled by Bhosle. And then, they were forced to accept subsidiary alliance first. But in 1854, that also dissolved. Now, in 1849 onwards, they conquered Punjab. Now, administrative structure is not good. And you have administrative problem. Like that they shown, and the territory of Bearer, today it is called as Vidarbha. So that part, that was also conquered. In 1856, Awadh, that is Ayodhya, that was also dissolved. Whereas, after death of Peshwa, that is Bajirao II, his adopted son, Nana Saheb Peshwa, was there on throne, but they refused to pay any pension to Nana Saheb Peshwa because they say that pension was there for your father only. With Bajirao Peshwa only, the pension was there. Now, this is all things carried out by Lord Dalhousie. Here, I must actually say that this is not a good thing carried out by Lord Dalhousie at that time. But after 1947, I must say thankful to Lord Dalhousie. Why? Because he dissolved so many princely states, our work was comparatively lessened. Just imagine, after freedom, more than 400 princely states were still remaining in India. And then credit goes to Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel that he dissolved that for betterment of India. What is difference between Lord Dalhousie and Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel? That Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel dissolved this princely state for betterment of India, integrity of India, whereas Lord Dalhousie was dissolving this state as his policy of expansion of company's empire. So for betterment of England, he was intended. Act is same. Both carried out same act. But the intention of Lord Dalhousie was done. Whereas from our side, the intention was bright. Anyway, but after that, he carried out lot of reform in telegram, postal services, then road. Now, Widow Remarriage Act was carried out during his rule in 1856, and currency, that rupaya, was restarted as their currency. Now, the first train was also developed. No doubt, intentionally, you are aware that Lord Harding is responsible for this thing. But during his rule, the railway started. That is from Mumbai. At that time, we are calling that as Mumbai railway station only. So from Mumbai to Thane, this first train, they started out. But within short period, the train network expanded to various parts in India. Now, he established first telegraph line, that was from Kolkata to Agra. And the Grand Trunk Road was repaired under his rule. He was, we can say, founder of British Empire. Then he started new concepts in administrative system. Whereas he encouraged people, Indian people, to follow British system, social systems of Britishers. He shifted capital from Kolkata, at that time Calcutta, to Simla during summer season only, not permanently. But during summer season, he said that in North India, tremendous heat is there. So we will go to Himalaya. And he shifted capital towards Simla, that is during summer period. Whereas he carried out another thing, that is Indian Remarriage Act. Hindu Remarriage Act, actually. So he carried out that. This is about Lord Dalhousie. Next Viceroy, next Governor General. But I am not wrong if I called him as Viceroy also. But initially he was Governor General. His name is Lord Canning, 1856 to 1858. He served India as a Governor General, and from 1858 to 1862, he served India as a Viceroy. So that's why I called him Viceroy also. So Lord Canning. Now, during his rule, the first important thing achieved, that is control over mutiny of sepoy from Britishers' side, and from Indian side, first Indian freedom struggle. So he was able to get control over that. and re-establishment of British Empire over India was achieved during his rule. So, according to that, 1857 mutiny of sepoy or revolt from Indian side, to freedom struggle of India, the first freedom struggle of India, all over India level. So that we are considering that everything crushed down by Lord Canning. So this is, we can say for us, instead of Canning, I should call him as Cunning, but he got success in doing all that. Now during his rule, the first thing he made that he abolished the practice, that is doctrine of lapse policy, that was started by Lord Dalhousie. So he abolished that practice. Then he said that ICS examinations, that should be conducted and Indians should be allowed to this ICS examination. Now Kolkata, that is Calcutta at that time, Bombay, Mumbai and Chennai, that Madras, universities were established there. Whereas he started era of development in India. Now Bombay, Madras and Kolkata, that is Mumbai, Chennai and Calcutta, high courts were established. Then ICS examinations was started during his rule, particularly after 1858 to 1862. In that, he started another important thing, that Indian diplomats and Indian rulers also were honored by entitling them as a sir. So these are chief things. So Lord Canning, I can say remarkable for first important thing, that is controlling British Empire during critical period. No doubt there was damage. He also accepted that there is damage, but his damage control policies were really very good, and he was able to control all this situation from worse situation from his side. From Indian side it was better situation, but from worse situation he controlled and he re-established British rule. But the major thing is that he was able to regain control over India with help of army sent by Britain. And therefore at 1858 the British Parliament started ruling over India directly, rather than companies rule. That major change was there. In 1858 they established they changed the name, what we are calling as Governor General of India. Instead of that they say it is Viceroy of India, the post. Okay, let me clarify to certain extent. So this is British Parliament. In British Parliament a post was created, that is called as Secretary of State. And Secretary of State was now answerable to British Parliament, and his representative in India, that was Viceroy. You are getting clear idea? To help Viceroy, a council was set out. These all establishments carried out during this British rule. So this way India is now under direct control of British rule at time of Lord Canning. So henceforth we are calling again as Viceroy of India. So Lord Canning is first Viceroy of India. Then onwards Lord Elgin first. He is also an important person, but he was able to rule only for 1 year. 1 year. During his rule he accepted a tolerant policy, but he died at Dharmashala. Followed by that, Sir John Lawrence was the next Viceroy of India. He ruled from 1864 to 69. Agricultural department was encouraged during his rule, particularly that irrigation department get activated. He protected India, and with respect to Afghanistan, they established some stagnant policy that we should not do anything regarding Afghanistan. So like that policies were there. But by the time he fought war with Bhutan and ultimately at end of his career, he observed a strong drought condition, famine in Odisha. Next was Lord Mayo, the next Viceroy. Now, I must say, you can call me violent, but it is dream that whether any Governor General or Viceroy was executed by any armed revolutionaries. Say, you are aware that armed revolutionaries executed various officers, right from Rand, Jackson, even Lord Harding, second, not first as we discussed, but second Lord Harding was also targeted, but not success. But only one Viceroy was executed by Indians at that time. His name was Afridi. The executor's name was Afridi. Sher Ali Afridi is his name. And he executed this Viceroy at Andaman. Practically, he was injured at Andaman, died in India. That Viceroy's name is Lord Earl of Mayo. I don't know the name of that person. He's called as Lord Earl of Mayo. He was related with royal family. He was son of Queen Victoria. And he was called as Duke of Edinburgh. So that Edinburgh's Duke and Lord Mayo. Now he was having something different Afghan policy. During his rule also, the Wahhabi movement that was going on in Northwest Frontier region, that was at its zenith. Britishers carried out a lot of efforts to crush down that movement, and in that a person named as Sher Ali Afridi was arrested, and he was sent for some longer punishment, some lifetime imprisonment like punishment was there at Andaman. Afridi was having only one argumentation, that whatever punishment given to me is much more than what the crime according to Britishers I have committed. Actually, he was not considering that what he was doing is crime. But according to Britishers also, what crime he was committed and what punishment was given. But then also he accepted that punishment. His rule in, his stay in that Andaman was nice. According to rule, he was staying there, and therefore he was considered as one of the best person who was prisoner over there. And then he was released from jail. Some land was allotted to him and asked him to stay outside the jail. And the thing happened that Lord Earl of Mayo decided to visit Andaman. He was awaiting for that, and surprisingly, he said that Lord Mayo is going to meet you. Why? Because those prisoners, they were very good behavior. Lord Earl of Mayo wanted to have introduction with them. And by making that advantage, he attacked over Lord Earl of Mayo. Lord Mayo was injured badly. He was taken immediately to Calcutta at that time, but he died there. Whereas this Afridi was tortured to very great extent by Britishers and ultimately hanged out till death. So this is Lord Earl of Mayo. Now he established responsible government over India. Then for agriculture and for businesses, separate departments were there. Now municipal councils were established during his rule. The next Viceroy, that is Lord Northbrook, from 1872 to 1876, this person was there. He was a very good administrator, and he was something like encouraging of freedom. For example, he says that why to that government should influence in public affair. As long as any political issues are not there, government should not indulge into public concerns. Let them rule accordingly. So minimum interference is the policy of this Lord Northbrook. Secondly, he tried to abolish various taxes. And he was saying that I want to rule peacefully over India. But by the time he carried out another thing, that ruler at Baroda was dethroned by him. Then in 1875, Prince of Wales visited India during his rule. He abolished income tax for a while. And now, next Viceroy, he was having that courage also to resign against own British government. At that time, ruler of Afghanistan was Sher Ali. And British Prime Minister Disraeli, you are aware that Disraeli is the person who is responsible to establish peace in eastern part of Europe during his rule. Particularly Prussian problems were solved and World War was extended, we can say the postponed. For that purpose, Disraeli is important. So Disraeli made some treaty with Sher Ali, but this Viceroy, Lord Northbrook, was not in favor of that, and so he opposed that. In order to show the protest, he resigned from his post. The next Viceroy was Lord Lytton. Lord Lytton was there from 1876 to 1880. Now, he reduced or abolished in taxes, that is import duties, over various things from Britain. But during his rule only, India faced tremendous famine at that time. He is the person who in 1877 declared Queen of Victoria, Queen of England, Victoria, as Empress of India, that is Kaiser A. Hind. So like that, activities were carried out. He fetched war against Afghanistan, but defeated in that war. Now, he made Arms Act. Accordingly that, Indians should not possess weapons. So that way he was imperialistic in nature. He passed out Vernacular Press Act. So whatever the, other than English newspapers were there, they were having various restrictions at that time. Then, he raised the age, decreased the upper limit of competitive examinations for government job from 21 year to 19 year. So this was actually critical thing from Indian side. But he carried out certain good things for Indian. For example, he established a committee to control drought condition. Then canals were constructed, roads were constructed during his rule. Whereas regional government, that we are calling as provincial government, he started giving them some of the revenue collected by central government to provincial government for betterment of the people. So that is why Lord Lytton, we can say, a mixed personality. No doubt towards imperialistic, obviously, then only person can sit on the throne. But after that, the policies were carried out. Now, after Lord Lytton, it was Lord Ripon. I'm revising again. Similar pronunciation, that's why confusion may be there. First one was Lytton. This one is Ripon. Really a great person from Indian side. We can say the best viceroy over, that is Lord Ripon only. Even Mountbatten is not that good as compared to Ripon. So he was a really popular viceroy in India. He passed out Factory Act. He established the municipal corporations. And the most important thing, during his rule, one thing achieved by Britishers, but that was boosted Indians, that is Gilbert Bill. You are aware that during British rule, judiciary system was established. They say in front of law, everybody is equal. So Indians were having right to sue case against Britishers. But at that time, it was decided that if any case where British versus British person is there in court, judge must be British. Indian versus Indian, judge can be British or can be Indian. But Indian versus British case, judge must be British. Actually, we have to replace word as European. Judge must be European. Now, if you compare it with doctor and patient, then doctor is doctor, patient is patient. Why we have to discriminate that doctor is Hindu and patient is Muslim and why like that? Only thing is that there is relationship between doctor and patient that is important. Religion, race, all these things are not important. But here, he says that judge must be European. Okay, so you are aware how justice was there during that period. So here, we can say that this was abolished by Lord Ripon. A bill was there that is called as Gilbert Bill. According to that bill, a white person and Indian can be tried by Indian judge also. Judge is judge ultimately. And this way, the bill was there, that Gilbert Bill. But when this bill was put forward, those Britishers were present in India. They started protesting against that bill. They fought against that bill and bill was taken back. This is the victory of British fight with Viceroy that boosted Indians. Why? Because by that time we were considering bill is there, that means it is going to get passed. Government will not take bill back. But here they establish, they observe that bill is taken back. And then onwards, in India also, the pressurizing group started rising, particularly during that period, encouraged. And then a movement started, particularly we are calling them as extremist people in Congress. Yet Congress is not established. But when Congress was established, slowly extremist groups started developing there. They were having ideology by Lord Ripon, that is of Gilbert Bill. That Gilbert Bill was taken back under pressure of white people, British people at that time. Now here, Lord Ripon also extended the civil examination from that age, from 19 years to 21 years once again. So he was favored at that time. Now he established William Wilson Hunter Commission for reforms in education. Then he abolished Vernacular Press Act, that is at 1881. Look carefully, one Viceroy will become maybe possible banned by passing out this type of act. Another will say, okay, I am liberal, I will abolish that. And this way, okay, British rule is continued. Getting idea? Okay. So this way, now Chief Justice of High Court, first time appointed as an Indian person during British rule. His name is Sir Ramesh Chandra Mitra. Now he re-established Mysore state and ultimately he carried out first regular census in India. That is at 1881. Now, he died in 1909, but he was ruling there till 1884. Then onwards, 1884 to 1888, Lord Dufferin was Viceroy. During his rule, Myanmar That means at that time it was called as Brahmadesh or Burma. This was dissolved and joined in India. During his rule only, Indian National Congress was established in Mumbai. Saint Tejpal Sanskrit Pathshala is the place where first session of Indian National Congress was conducted. The second session was conducted at Kolkata or Calcutta, where at that time it was having doubt that this Congress was established by British government only. We are not having clear cut, we can say, but it is having theory that is called as safety wall theory. And retired ICS officer Alan Hume established Congress. His efforts were there, but under his guidance, Indians only established this Congress. So that was there. Then Lord Dufferin started Lady Dufferin Fund for women health care. He started that fund. Now, Britain's king, queen, that is Victoria, she was there on throne for 25 years, and for that purpose he celebrated Silver Jubilee of that empire. And lastly, at time of marriage, girl, I'm not saying woman, girl should have minimum age of 12 years. That was passed during his rule. Earlier that, it was around 10 years was decided. Now they say that, okay, 12 years minimum age should be there of girl at time of marriage. Then next viceroy is having name Lord Lansdowne. So he was there from 1888 to 94. Now he was aggressive in nature. He was there. First thing, his task was there to secure Indian boundaries at that time, and therefore he decided to make defense service good. But there was dispute yet going on between Afghanistan and India. Large part of Afghanistan was controlled by India at that time, but not Afghanistan was defeated completely. And ultimately, they established a line that is called as Durand Line, which was agreed by both that Afghan king and Indian person. And then the border between Afghanistan and India was set out. At that time, India. Now it is obviously Pakistan, but that was said that is called as Durand Line. Now, they started out election by Council Act. But that is, actually we are saying that indirect election that was started. Now in industries, women were working. Their working hours were restricted to 7 hours per day and weekly one holiday. So like that, things were carried out by this person. The next, that is Lord Elgin II. He was there from 1894. To 1899. Now see the difference. Till earlier Viceroy, Congress was not there, but now Congress, Indian National Congress, is functional. Now during his rule, there was revelation of Santhal, that is in 1899, because as it was promised in declaration of Queen after 1857's War of Independence, but Britishers slowly abolished the thing, and therefore it happened. Now he also faced terrible famine condition during his rule, whereas he established a single commander-in-chief for three places, Mumbai, Madras and Bengal. 1896, he faced a terrible problem in India, that is plague was there in India, spread out widely. And then you are aware of the important thing, that is assassination of Rand, a commissioner of Pune, and Ayerst. This happened. Now next viceroy, his name is Lord Curzon. Don't confuse with Curzon Wiley. Curzon Wiley is some different person, whereas his name is Lord Curzon. He ruled from 1899 to 1905. You are aware of its imperialistic approach, particularly Congress turnout from moderate to extremist view during his rule only. He was actually very good person in certain aspect. Say for example, he paid lot of attention towards irrigation under leadership of Sir Colin Scott. Irrigation commission was set. Then accordingly they established canal and on Jhelum River. Now he established various committees, whereas he was partial towards Muslim side because he passed out Punjab Land Transfer Act. Now he protected Indian monuments. For that purpose also he made act. Now he made act for cooperative banks also. During his rule, maximum railway lines were established in India other than all Viceroy's rule. He was really a great person for his motherland. But practically speaking, in India, he was considered as a villain because of the divide and rule policy. He divided Bengal. He administered, he said that administration of Bengal province is not clearly possible under this Bengal. And so we have to divide Bengal into East Bengal and West Bengal. This was clear-cut idea that at that time East Bengal was Muslim dominated, West Bengal was Hindu dominated. And so the dispute between Hindus and Muslims will start rising. And to oppose that, at that time people of Congress were united under leadership of Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Lala Lajpat Rai and Bipin Chandra Pal. This is called as Vanga Bhanga, that is partition of Bengal, to protest that. And ultimately he resigned, or say that he was forced to resign from that post prior to the, I hope, few days earlier than actual partition of Bengal took place. Okay, and in later on, the revolutionary movement was so dominating that in 1911, Britishers took that partition back. But the impact that was today also, you are saying, observing that separate Bangladesh is today also existing. So this is the way Britishers ignited people at that time. And that's why Congress leaders were in opposition of partition of Bengal. Anyway, according to him, during his rule only, National Congress will come to end. Like that he was speaking at that time. Now, after this rule, another person was there on throne. His name is Lord Minto II. I am purposefully saying throne because no doubt he was not king. But in India, their behavior is something like king only. Because of that, they were able to implement their own policies over here. So, Lord Minto II. We discussed that first Lord Minto was there. Now this is Lord Minto II. We are aware of Morley Minto Act. In that, Minto is Viceroy of India. That was passed in 1909. The most important thing that Indians were having representation in government, but we can say the communal base politics started because of that all thing. Particularly, you are aware for Muslims, they given separate electorate. What is the meaning of that? In single constituency, one candidate will be from open community and one from Muslim community. Like that, separate electorates were given to Muslim people at that time. This means they started discriminating Indian as Hindus and Muslims. During this Lord Curzon and then onwards Lord Minto, the policies of Britishers change. You are aware that at 1857, Mughal Empire was declared as Emperor of India once again. They observed that Muslims are in against government at that time, British government. And so earlier policies of Britishers were something like that. that we had to keep Muslims away. But after 1900 onwards, they changed out policies and they taken their hands towards Muslims to make friendship. Why? Because Congress was established and they started a sort of, we can say, upwards. Initially only, no doubt they were moderate, and after Congress become extremist, they wanted to crush down Congress, and for that purpose they shifted their view towards Muslim side. So these all things happened during Lord Minto. After that, he faced a terrible upwards by Indians on Western goods, because we started opposing. We are using technique of boycott. At that time, Dada Bhai Nauroji became chairperson of Congress session, and then he said that we have to follow fourfold path, that is freedom, that is Swarajya, according to him. To get Swarajya, we have to boycott Western good, foreign good, we have to use Indian good and national education. That happened. Now we are switching over to next Viceroy, that is Lord Harding's second. Second, everywhere we are now saying that Lord Harding's second. During his rule, King of England, that is George V, visited India, particularly Delhi. Now, during his rule, capital of India was shifted from Kolkata to Delhi. Sorry, New Delhi, because Delhi is Indian original capital. So they established new city outside Delhi, and that is administrative area given name as New Delhi. Harding decided to enter in Delhi like Mughal emperor, by sitting on throne which was mounted on elephant. And a great revolutionist, armed revolutionist from India, his name is Ras Bihari Bose, decided, I'm calling him as the most successful armed revolutionist, that is Ras Bihari Bose, decided to take wicket of this Lord Harding. He used bomb. Just he entered in Delhi, a bomb was thrown on him, but very unfortunate, I don't know cricket practice was prominent in India at that time or not, but throw was missed, and instead of that Harding's, his orderly was injured in the bomb blast. But plus point is that Ras Bihari Bose was not also arrested. By taking advantage of this all crowd, he mixed out in that crowd, and nobody was aware that this is carried out by Ras Bihari Bose at that time. Later on, Ras Bihari Bose escaped to Japan, secretly obviously. Rest of history in next lecture. So Lord Harding's, that is the important thing, that he shifted capital towards Delhi. Second thing he achieved, that he shifted, he abolished the partition of Bengal. And Bengal was reunited during 1911. Then onwards, Lord Chelmsford. In his spelling, why L is put, I don't know, but not called as Chelmsford. L is silent. So he was there during 1916 to 1921. Important thing during his rule, that is Rowlatt Act. I want to discuss much of the things about Rowlatt Act, but this is not right time, because we are discussing with reference to this Viceroy. So we are discussing in detail afterwards, but let me introduce some part. Lala Hardaya, a great member of International Revolutionist Organization, that is Abhinav Bharat, freedom fighter Savarkar, made this organization, international organization, which was consisting of various, they were having connection with various other nations' revolutionists, obviously armed revolutionists. Because Savarkar was not believing in this non-violence and all that, and at that time non-violence was not there. So he was violent. They established their, what we can say, organization, which was including of Ireland at that time, Egypt, China, parts of Russia, Russian people were also there, and German Emperor Kaiser William II was encouraging these people for this act. The plan, initial plan was something like that. After First World War will started, they were not aware when it is going to start. But after outbreak of First World War, we had to carry out armed revolution in all these nations. Like that things. But unfortunately, Savarkar was arrested in some different matter. And later on, he was sent for lifetime deportation, a lifetime imprisonment at Andaman. But one of the members, named as Lala Hardaya of Abhinav Bharat, managed to escape from England and reach to USA and then in Canada. And with his efforts, a movement started there that is called as Gadar Movement. Savarkar was at Andaman, but these people were free. They established their Gadar Movement, and clan was there through Punjab territory. And then Kaiser William II sent a ship, warship, filled with weapons. That ship was assigned two tasks. First task is to attack over Andaman Nicobar Islands, particularly Andaman, and release armed revolutionaries from that jail. And second task, take that weapons to Punjab, and armed revolution will be started from Punjab. We had to attack over India from outside. And that's why when Britishers were come to know, because Britishers were having very good spy system, the warship having name as Amden, that was destroyed somewhere in the Bay of Bengal, whereas Punjab was now forcing martial law. More than 5,000 people were arrested and punished. Minimum punishment was of 2 years imprisonment, to maximum punishment was given to Vishnu Ganesh Pingale and Kartar Singh Sarabha, that is death penalty. Many of them forced to go to Andaman for 25 years lifetime imprisonment. And like that, various punishments were given. We are calling this all as Lahore Conspiracy. The outbreak of this, that martial law was said, and the Punjab was so violent at that time that Britishers established the Rowlatt Act. These all things happened during Lord Chelmsford. And then you are aware that the famous incident, that is Jallianwala Bagh massacre, was there during his rule only. Now, Lokmanya Tilak started Home Rule League movement at his rule only, whereas Khilafat movement was started during his rule only. Whereas at end of World War, during his rule, First World War ended, and then he given reforms, that is called as Montagu-Chelmsford reforms. What is the most important peculiarity of this reform? That Indian person can become minister according to these reforms. What Lokmanya Tilak was proclaiming, that I want freedom, it is my birthright, that was said by Montagu-Chelmsford reform only. They say that ultimately our aim is to make you eligible for that, and for that purpose we will give you training, and step by step power will be transferred to your hand. Step by step means every 10 years they will give new steps to you. So freedom by installment, something like that concept was there. So according to that, in 1999, the first important thing we got, that we were having ability to rule as a minister. First time Indian person was able to become minister during his rule. Now, after Chelmsford, Lord Reading was Viceroy. During his rule, Swarajya Paksha or Swarajya Party was established, and they participated in the council. Then important role, Viceroy Lord Irving. Now I am not going to discuss in detail with respect to that because we are already having these lectures and you are aware of the thing. So much of the thing I am not going to discuss, only important things I am going to discuss. That Lord Irving, you are aware that Lord Irving was there from 1926 to 1931 as Mahatma Gandhi started out that movement that is called as civil disobedience movement. Lord Irving asked him to pause that movement. Keep in mind, not stop, pause. And then there was pact between Gandhiji and Irving. That is called as Gandhi-Irving pact. And then Gandhiji was sent to England to participate in second round table conference. But the question is that why round table conference were conducted? This was actually suggestion of Barrister Jinnah with help of this Swarajya party's people. And so that was the reason that this round table conference were conducted. You are aware that Montague Chelmsford reform, they were giving reforms after 10 years. So in 1929, because 1919 reforms were there. So in 29 also we should get reform. But for that purpose, they assigned a commission that is called as Simon Commission. This is also during rule of Lord Irving. Whereas Congress people protested that Simon Commission because not a single Indian person was there on that commission. And so these all things happened. Civil disobedience movement happened during Lord Irving's rule only. And then there was a person, as we discuss here, that is Secretary of State. His name was at that time Lord Birkenhead. He said this way that all Indians will come together and give acceptable constitution is not possible. And Congress worked on that statement, whereas they established a committee under leadership of Pandit Motilal Nehru. I am revising, Pandit Motilal Nehru. And then a constitution was framed. This is called as Nehru Report. No doubt, Barrister Jinnah turned again. He said that these are my 14 demands. But the demands were not accepted by Nehru Report. So he submitted that 14 demands separately. Okay, so that happened. But when Nehru Report was not enforced by Britishers and not any communication was there, then Congress decided to get complete freedom. At 1929, Lahore session was there. The chairperson of that Lahore person was Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, young person at that time. And he said that we want complete freedom. So this is about Lord Irving's rule. Now next Viceroy was Lord Willington, where the second round table conference was conducted during his rule. Next Viceroy. Now during Lord Willington, second and third round table conference took place, whereas we are saying it is the communal award of Ramsay MacDonald was given during his rule only. Gandhiji was there at that time at Yeroda jail. He started fast until death. And then there was Pune pact between Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar and Mahatma Gandhi. Now, during Lord Willington's rule only, all of a sudden British government changed. And the Act of 1935 was given. So, these changes are observed during Lord Willington's rule that India got a dominion status as it was demanded in Nehru Report. Now next Lord, next Viceroy, obviously Lord Linlithgow, he ruled from 36 to 44. Initial stage of his rule was very nice because provincial governments were given to Indians. Indians were busy in election and all these work. According to 1935's law, elections were conducted during 1937, and self-government, a sort of self-government, was given to Indians at that time. Whereas when World War started in 39, Linlith Gold stated that India will participate in the World War from British side. And it is said that without consulting leaders of Congress, he declared, and therefore we resigned from all these provincial governments. But during his rule only, Cripps mission was sent to discuss problem of freedom with Indians. Obviously, Cripps mission was sent in this way that USA was demanding that we had to do something for Indian and for that purpose. But failure of Cripps mission was actually success of Cripps mission. Keep in mind. So Cripps mission was having failure. And last, the Quit India movement started during his rule only. That is at 1942. Okay, he was ruling till 44. Then onwards, for short period, another viceroy was there named as Lord Wavell. He was there on throne in 1944. Almost World War was towards end portion. And ultimately Hitler committed suicide. World War ended for Europe. Followed by that, World War ended in Japan also within few months. And then there was end of World War. World was changing out. Britain become very, very weak power because of this World War. Hitler and his great army defeated Britain everywhere, every possible thing. But ultimately, with help of Russia, with help of America, and obviously British great army was able to manage victory. But Britain suffered a lot. And therefore, they were not in position to hold this vast empire in their hand now. And therefore, they decided to give freedom. So, this major period was controlled by Lord Wavell. And ultimately, as his plan was having failure, that is called as Wavell plan, he was called back. And then, the last viceroy was appointed from royal family, that is Lord Mountbatten. We are going to discuss what happened during Lord Mountbatten during that Indian freedom struggle only. And so I am not discussing much of the thing during Lord Mountbatten. But the most important thing I must tell, that is partition of India. And then onwards, unification of princely states in India. Obviously, if I am Pakistani, I must call unification of princely state with Pakistan. So that things happened. Because as we unified India, they also unified Pakistan. So, that things happened during this Viceroy, Lord Mountbatten. But after 1947, that means 15th August 1947, we requested Mountbatten to be there in India. Pakistanis never requested, but Indians requested. We are aware who is that Indian who requested, etc. But we requested him to stay over here. And then, he was not called as Viceroy because Viceroy is representative of British Parliament. Now here he was representative, no. But from all over Indian side, so he is called as Governor General. So we discuss after 58 from Governor General to Viceroy and now from Viceroy to Governor General. So Lord Mountbatten was first Governor General of Free India. Tragedy, but yes. So 1947 to 48, he was their first Governor General. After 48, he returned back to England. And then he was assassinated by Irish armed revolutionists. Why? Because there is dispute between Ireland and England. I am purposefully calling is. It is not was. Was also and is also. And so, Viceroy was assassinated by Irish armed revolutionaries. Again, very pity, not from Indian side, because of partitioning of Indian Empire. Okay? He is responsible for massacre of so many people during partition. He was aware what is going to happen, but still, he was not able to get control.
Otherwise, direct action plan by Muslim League. No doubt, provincial government was there in hands of Suhrawardi. But your central government was there. Why don't you enforce your power so that violence should get minimized? What is about your that martial law, military rule, all these things? So, Viceroy, that Mountbatten was responsible, and we are the people who say that, okay, after freedom also, please stay here. So in 1942, we were calling quit India. And in 1947, we say stay in India, rule over India. That is the thing. Anyway, so Lord Mountbatten, he ruled from 47 to 48. And after that, the first Governor General from Indian side and last Governor General also, same person, that was C. Rajagopalachari from 1948 to 1950. He was there. Alright. So this is, we are discussing conquest of India with reference to British policies, British governors, Governor of Bengal, Governor General of Bengal, Governor General of India, Viceroy of India. And at end only, like I am telling that after that it turns again to Governor General of India, and now there is no post that is called as Governor General of India. We are calling that as Rashtrapati, the President of India. So I am ending this lecture here. Thanks for patient listening.